And worship tonight, hymn number 99, Not All the Blood of Beasts. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Do not withhold your mercy from me, O Yahweh.
May your love and your truth always protect me.
For troubles without number surround me. My sins have overtaken me, and I cannot see. Be pleased, O Yahweh, to save me. O Yahweh, come quickly to help me.
I am poor and needy. May the Lord think of me. You are my help and my deliverer. O my God, do not delay.
Holy and gracious God, I confess that I have sinned against you. Some of my sin I know, the thoughts and words and deeds of which I am ashamed. But some is known only to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, I ask forgiveness. Deliver and restore me, that I may rest in peace. Amen. Receive the forgiveness of your sins that Christ won for you by his passion, his death, and his resurrection. As a called and ordained servant of the Word and by his authority, I therefore forgive you of all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Thank you. it's time for the children's message. So kids, you want to come on up, have a seat on the floor. So how long is the season of Lent? 40 days. Not counting what? Not counting Sundays. She whispered it, but she did say it. Doesn't have a lot of conviction behind that, but she did whisper it. Not counting Sundays. It's 40 days long. So during Lent now, we're looking at other events that happened in the Bible that were also 40 days, or at least had the number 40 in them. Who remembers what the first thing was that we talked about 3 weeks ago? Noah's Ark. Where's the 40 in Noah's Ark? 40 days of rain, exactly, 40 days of rain. The flood lasted much longer. They were on the ark for much, much longer than that, but the rain came down for the 40 days. And we emphasized that that was God's judgment, okay? But God also saved Noah in the ark, right? Saved Noah and his family in the ark. So Jesus, he's going to come back for judgment. Yeah, that's going to be bad, but he's provided a way to be saved. And that's through Jesus Christ himself. Okay, then the next week, what was the 40? What was the 40 that we had the second week? Do you remember? 40 days of wandering in the desert. Wandering in the desert, very good, very good. Except that it wasn't 40 days. What was it? 40 what?
Nights.
40 nights. It was 40 years, okay? So they were wandering. They'd come out of Egypt, they were going to the promised land, but they rebelled against God, and so God made them wander around in the wilderness for 40 years. But he was with them all the time, wasn't he? He was with them with a pillar of cloud by day, a pillar of fire by night, and then finally he brought them into the promised land. That's like us. We're living in this world. We're going through our world. Wherever we might be going, God is with us every single day. He's leading us, and he's taking us where? Finally, to be with him in heaven. Okay? So that was the 40 there. What was the 40 last week? Okay, congregation, your turn to shine. What was the 40 last week? Moses on the mountain, exactly. Moses going up on a mountain. God brought the people of Israel to Mount Sinai, remember? And then he gave them the Ten Commandments and so on. But then he said, Moses, come back up. I got more to tell you. And then at the top of the mountain, God gave Moses all kinds of instructions, particularly about how to build the tabernacle. That was their church. And God said, basically, I'm going to be with you. I'm going to be with you. And he showed them how to offer sacrifices and how his love would come to them. It was amazing. That was the 40 days, just like Lent is 40 days. God is with us, and he shows how his love comes to us through the sacrifice of Jesus. Okay, now we got another 40. My guess is that you're not going to know this one. My guess is the congregation isn't going to know this one either, okay? They've probably been trying to figure out what other 40s are there in the scripture. I bet they don't know this one. It's an Old Testament one, and it has to do with David. It has to do with David. Anyone have any idea? Good thing you came tonight, because you're going to learn something. You're going to learn something that you did not know. David. David was just a teenager. He had already been anointed or chosen to be the next king of Israel, but he wasn't the king yet. He was just a young kid. And while he was just a young kid, it happened that at one time there was an army of the Philistines that gathered against the army of the Israelites. One was on a mountain over here, one was on a hill mountain over here, and there was a valley in between them. And it was kind of a standoff. Until one man from the Philistines came and issued a challenge to the Israelite army. Do you know who that man was? Goliath. That's the story, okay? The 40's coming up. 40's coming up. Goliath was a big, big man. Do you know how tall he was? 9 feet tall. He was the guy you wanted on your basketball team. Oh my God, 9 feet tall. And the Israelites were probably like me, less than 6 feet tall. And Goliath just wasn't big. He also had armor. He had a lot of armor. It was beautiful. He covered his whole body just about. And the Israelites hardly had any armor at all. The king had some, but that was about it. And so Goliath stood there. He said, "This is what we're going to do. I will come out, and you guys, you choose one guy to come out from your army. One-on-one, we'll have a battle. And whoever wins is going to be the victor for the entire army. And the loser is going to have to serve the winner." And the Israelites panicked. They panicked. They said, "We can't beat this guy. There's no way we can defeat him." And Goliath kept coming out in the morning and in the evening and saying the same thing. And guess how long he did that? 40 days. There's the 40. There's the 40. 40 days he issued this challenge, both in the morning and in the evening. On the 40th day, David came along. David had been home tending the sheep. He didn't have any armor. He wasn't even in the military. He wasn't a soldier. He was a shepherd boy. But he looked at this whole thing very differently than everyone else. All the Israelites looked at Goliath and they just trembled. They were afraid. But David looked at it this way. He said, that Goliath, he believes in a God that doesn't even exist. Doesn't even exist. He's got no power at all. We believe in the true God, the God who made the universe, the God who brought us out of Egypt, the God who's with us right now. He's got power. Who's going to win this battle? Our God is going to win this battle, and he's going to do it through me. At first, the other soldiers and King Saul kind of looked at David, you know, short little David, no training, and they kind of said, "Oh my God, this isn't going to happen." But then David kept saying, "God, God is powerful. God loves us. God's on our side. We can win this battle." So finally, King Saul kind of threw up his hands and said, "Okay, David, go for it." And you know what happened, right? David took 5 small stones, went out to meet Goliath. Goliath laughed at him. Laughed at him, said, "Boy, this is going to be so simple." Probably thinking, "I can just swat him and he's going to be gone." But David had God on his side. And David took a slingshot. And this was a slingshot that he kind of whipped around like this. He put one stone in there. And he prayed. And he let that stone fly. And it went right into Goliath's forehead. And it went so hard into Goliath's forehead, it sunk in and it hit his brain. And he died. And it was over. It was over. David had won the battle after 40 days. Okay, now we're in Lent, right? We're in Lent. Jesus, he's going up against an enemy too. Not one who's 9 feet tall, not one with armor. He's going up a greater enemy than that. He's going up against Satan. He's going up against sin. He's going up against death. Who could possibly defeat him? Well, at the end of Lent, 40 days, Jesus wins the battle. And it's in your Bible. Exactly. It's in the Bible that Jesus wins the battle. Jesus wins. And it's victory for everyone else, including you and me. So here was another 40. Just remember, at the end of 40 days, David won. At the end of 40 days of Lent, Jesus wins, because it's Easter. Lent ends with Easter. Jesus is alive. All right? Okay, got another little worksheet here for you guys. You guys can go back to your seats after you get one of these. Thank you very much for coming up again. You're welcome. There you go. There you go. And now we'll let Pastor Steve continue with the scripture readings for tonight. The topic for our At the Crossroads is compassion. Listen to that as you hear Pastor Steve read.
The Old Testament reading from the prophet Isaiah. I will tell of the kindnesses of Yahweh, the deeds for which he is to be praised, according to all Yahweh has done for us. Yes, the many good things he has done for the house of Israel, according to his compassion and many kindnesses. He said, surely these are my people, sons who will not be false to me. And so he became their savior. In all their distress, he too was distressed, and the angel of his presence saved them. In his love and mercy, he redeemed them. He lifted them up and carried them all the days of old. This is the word of our Lord. The epistle from Paul's letter to the church in Colossae. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive whatever grievances you may have against one another. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace. And be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom, and as you sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs with gratitude in your hearts to God. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. This is the word of our Lord. And the Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 22nd chapter. Jesus went out as usual to the Mount of Olives, and his disciples followed him. On reaching the place, he said to them, "Pray that you will not fall into temptation." He withdrew about a stone's throw beyond them, knelt down and prayed, "Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done." An angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him. And being in anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground. When he rose from prayer and went back to the disciples, he found them asleep, exhausted from sorrow. "Why are you sleeping?" he asked them. "Get up and pray so that you will not fall into temptation." While he was still speaking, a crowd came up, and the man who was called Judas, one of the 12, was leading them. He approached Jesus to kiss him. But Jesus asked him, "Judas, are you betraying the Son of Man with a kiss?" When Jesus' followers saw what was going to happen, they said, "Lord, should we strike with our swords?" And one of them struck the servant of the high priest, cutting off his right ear. But Jesus answered, "No more of this." And he touched the man's ear and healed him. This is the gospel of our Lord. Please rise as we confess together our common Christian faith. I believe that Jesus Christ, true God, begotten of the Father from eternity, and also true man, born of the Virgin Mary, is my Lord, who has redeemed me, a lost and condemned person, purchased and won me from all sins, from death, and from the power of the devil, not with gold or silver, but with his holy precious blood, and with his innocent suffering and death, that I may be his own, and live under him in his kingdom, and serve him in everlasting righteousness, innocence, and blessedness, just as he is risen from the dead, lives and reigns to all eternity. This is most certainly true.
Thank you.
Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, the crossroads that we've been talking about, the crossroads that are often before us, we may find ourselves moving easily along from one day to the next, walking, enjoying that nice spring day, feeling peaceful, feeling calm, and then it comes, a crossroad, a point at which we find ourselves needing to make a choice. And there yet we stand, frozen in our place, not knowing how to respond. Do we head to the right or to the left? Do we keep straight on the path that we had been before? What awaits at the end of each of those roads? Which way is our heart telling us to go? Which way does our mind tell us to go? What makes most sense? Or which way does God want us to go? Those answers aren't always easy either. And these crossroads can bring with them a great deal of pain. They can humble us and bring us to our knees, and they can even bring us to our own destruction. Tonight with us, we have an expert on the crossroad of compassion. He saw a choice before him that changed his life. Please welcome with me tonight, Malchus, guard and servant to the high priest Caiaphas of Israel. Good evening, Caiaphas. Malchus, welcome. Thank you for joining us.
I am the servant of Caiaphas. I am not Caiaphas.
Thanks for clearing that up.
He would probably slap me if I heard that. I thank you for inviting me. I will be the first, however, to say that I really am no one important, and I'm not really sure that I deserve to be here. I am just a servant. That's all. I'm a guard as well. I happen to be a servant to the high priest. Yes, Caiaphas is his name. It's not a glamorous job. I just do my job. It's what a servant has to do. I do it fairly well. Caiaphas seems to trust me. But to be in the spotlight, to be front and center, that's for the master. That's not where a servant belongs. And the only reason that I am here is because of one single act of kindness.
That act of kindness, I would guess, then relates to Jesus. I mean, that's where we know your name from, is from your dealings in the life and ministry of Jesus. Can you tell us more about that?
The incident happened when Judas led us to Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane that night. We had gone there to arrest Jesus, of course, and Judas identified him with a kiss. But I actually had seen Jesus earlier that week. Jesus had been publicly preaching and teaching and so on, and the church council, and Caiaphas, very specifically, were getting to be quite nervous about him and quite upset with him. And there were a couple of times during that week when Caiaphas told me, as guard, to go with some of his friends, his Pharisees and the other leaders, to go and talk with Jesus. It wasn't that I was supposed to talk with Jesus. I don't always say everything very well. I'm not a public speaker. It wasn't that I was to talk with him. I was just going along to protect and make sure that nothing happened. But these gentlemen went to talk to Jesus. And I remember very specifically that they were looking to find something against him.
How did you feel about the way they were doing that, the way that they were approaching Jesus?
Well, at first, frankly, I didn't really mind at first because it was something different. You know, otherwise, as a guard, you know, I hang around at the council and not really do a whole lot. Or if Caiaphas gets in, I shouldn't say this, but if he gets in one of his moods, it can be a pretty difficult job. So for me to go out and be with some other people was kind of a pleasure for me.
Your attitude, though, about all of this has changed in
well, it,
some
it
way?
Did. It did. I, like Caiaphas and the rest of the leaders, had kind of assumed that Jesus was a threat, that he was someone to worry about, to be concerned about. But then I heard the kinds of things that Jesus answered to the scribes and the Pharisees who asked him the questions. And I saw him do miracles. He did so many miracles right there in Jerusalem. It was mostly miracles of healing. People had been sick, and Jesus healed them, and they were whole. And there was even people that were possessed with demons. And Jesus cast out those demons. You know, I was hearing Jesus, I was seeing Jesus, and frankly, nothing that I saw or heard, you know, caused me any kind of concern. But there was this underlying thought that Jesus was a threat, a real big threat. And it was based upon the fact that some of his followers, very specifically, were talking about Jesus being a king, and had come very specifically to establish a kingdom. And even, they were saying, to get rid of the Romans, to start a revolt against them.
We certainly are aware of that. The disciples had no place or use for the Romans. What about you?
I didn't either, be perfectly honest. Didn't have any use for the Romans whatsoever. The Romans were horrible, horrible people. They oppressed us. They very specifically treated us like dirt. They treated us like slaves. They took advantage of us whenever they possibly could. So if, in fact, Jesus' disciples were going to overthrow Rome or start a rebellion that led to the overthrow of Rome, you know, on the one hand, but then on the other hand, I knew very well that if that happened, Rome would respond quickly and brutally. They would come down hard, and there would be bloodshed galore. And therefore, as I thought about how this was all going on, I really don't know how I felt about it altogether.
And yet you went along. I mean, when the leaders asked you to go to the garden with them with the arrest, you went.
Yeah. Well, I'm a servant. I didn't have any choice. It wasn't like Caiaphas asked for volunteers. Caiaphas told me this is what I had to do, and I have to do whatever he tells me. So we went. We went very specifically expecting trouble. We did. We expected trouble. Now, it was true that we went to Jesus at night. We went to Jesus when the crowds that had followed him all week were going to be celebrating Passover in their homes. We went where it was dark. We knew his close followers, his disciples as he called them, would be there with him. But we were pretty confident that we could take them. However, we were prepared. We were prepared that if they were threatened, certainly they were going to resist.
Were you afraid?
Afraid? No, not really. I'm a guard. I was trained in military tactics, really. I knew how to handle a sword. And more than that, not only could I handle a sword, but I had the attitude that made me handle it efficiently and quickly. You see, the world that I lived in was one of strike hard. If someone attacks you, you attack back harder. So that not only stops them, but it stops anyone else from getting dumb ideas. I was of a mindset that it was better to actually strike first. Strike first, because then you've got the advantage. I was a guard, and that meant I protected not only myself, I protected the high priest. And I could not let anything happen to him, so I had to be ready. And I went to that garden that night, and I was ready. I was ready to do what was ever necessary to attack first, to make sure that I was protected and Jesus was arrested. But then, in spite of all my planning, instead of all my preparations, something happened that changed everything. We had gone to follow Judas. He kissed Jesus, identified him. We stepped forward to arrest Jesus. And just like we had anticipated, there was trouble. I learned later it was a man by the name of Peter who grabbed his sword and he started flinging it. And he cut off my ear. The pain was horrific. Instinctively, I just took my hand quickly and I touched my ear and I had blood running down my hand and arm. It hurt badly in a way that I had never ever experienced. So I was ready. I was ready. My military training kicked in and I was ready to strike back. That's how I'd lived.
And yet you stopped.
Yeah. That's the incomprehensible part about it all. Jesus held up his hand. My first thought was, this is a signal. This is a sign that everyone else was now supposed to get out their swords and start swinging them too. But while he held up his hand, the words that came out of his mouth betrayed that idea. He said to everyone, put your swords away. Stop. No more of this. And admittedly, I kind of froze for a second, half a second. And then I again saw his hand. I saw his hand, it was getting closer to me. He was going to grab me. He was going to hit me. He was going to hurt me somehow. But it only took a second. And he gently took his hand and laid it on my ear. I remember feeling the touch. It was gentle. It was healing. Yeah, healing. He healed my ear. As soon as he touched it, the pain was gone. The pain was gone. There was something that happened. Something miraculous.
Yeah, we can't even begin to imagine what feeling that must have been like. Would you say that then that changed you, changed the way that you were looking at everything that was going on?
In more ways than I'm even discovering to this day. He healed my ear, but he also touched my spirit. He really did. You see, here was one who I knew had power to prevent his arrest. He could have done something. I saw those miracles that he did in Jerusalem. And frankly, that very night, when we approached, Judas went and kissed Jesus. And then Jesus said this to all of us. He said, who is it that you're looking for? And I and everyone else said, Jesus of Nazareth. And then three words came out of his mouth. I am he. But I never felt anything like this, and I can't even explain it. As he said those words, we got pushed back. Some of us even fell to the ground. There was a power. There was a power in those words. This Jesus could have used that power to stop what was happening. That's what I would have done. And yet, he used his power to heal, to care, to love. It was as if, at that moment, a light went on inside of me, inside my spirit. Something was happening that, frankly, I really didn't understand.
Can you tell us any more about that light that you were just mentioning?
Well, yeah. Like I said, I'm not a man of good words, and I can't explain things very well, but it, in an instant, it seemed like everything that I had done before, the things that I had done according to my training, you know, take care of yourself, protect, defend, strike first. I saw all those times when I did that. I saw all those times when I hurt someone, when I very specifically did whatever I could to gain the advantage over them. I saw all those individual things flash in my mind, and then everything went dark. But there was a light that started to shine. A light that showed a better way of doing things. A light that showed a very different way to live.
So, with that different way to live, I mean, how did that then play out for you?
I'm not a very good guard anymore. I don't handle my sword like I used to. If you're going to handle a sword well, you have to have the mental attitude that goes with it. The attitude I already told you about. But now, I see things differently. I see things, it's hard for me even to say this, from a compassionate point of view, with mercy, with kindness. I make different choices.
Would you say that that has made life maybe easier for you?
Easier? No. 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 It's very easy. It's very easy just to let your nature well up and do the first thing that comes to you. That's not hard. That you can do. When someone strikes you, you can strike back quickly. That is easy. But this way of compassion, this way of caring, that's hard. And it's so different. In Jesus, I saw a different way. A better way. It was a way that healed me here and in here. He healed my ear and he healed my heart.
If you could just leave us with one statement, one message tonight, what would you want them to remember about this interview?
You asked me to put things into words. I would say it'd be this. For me, when I'm challenged to do the easy thing, which is the hurtful, hateful thing, I see the face of Jesus, and I see that hand coming to touch me. And then I know what I need to do. What I want to do. If ever you're in that place when temptation is rising up to get revenge, to hit, to hurt, to say something bad, to put someone down, think of the face of Jesus, the compassionate Jesus who reaches out his hand even to you. I don't know if I said that well, but that would be my most important thing.
It doesn't sound all that unfamiliar to what we were just reading this evening together. As Paul had said in his letter to the people in Colossae, put on then, as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience, bearing with one another, and if one has a complaint against another, forgiving each other as the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. And above all these, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony.
That's the life that I found in Jesus, and I hope it's for all of you.
So the first thing to say about the script that we had tonight is, it was more made up than normal. historically speaking, we know nothing about Malchus other than what is recorded. We get that little verse that we had tonight in our gospel reading from Luke. There's another little verse in the gospel reading from John that's very similar, except for John actually mentions the name, which is where we get the name Malchus from. Other than that, so we know his name is Malchus. He served as a guard or a servant to the priest,
to the high priest.
And then Peter chopped off his ear.
And it was healed. It was healed.
And Jesus restored his ear and his hearing. That's all that Scripture says. We have nothing else in the Bible, and I didn't go digging deep into the church fathers to see, but I don't know that history really says anything about this gentleman either. We don't know, but at the same time, you can see what they were attempting to do. It would be nice to say Malchus had that happened to him that night, and suddenly that realization of who Christ was and what Christ had come to do just dawned on him, and yes, this conversion that we kind of see in the script happened, but we just don't know. So we can see what they were trying to do, though. They were trying to point out, as we have on the screen there, the crossroad of compassion. That's what they were trying to get at. They really wanted to emphasize that particular point.
And this account does that very, very nicely. This whole thing about compassion. Compassion, just kind of quickly, we don't have a whole lot of time, but compassion is defined as having a sympathy, a deep sympathy, even a sorrow for someone in distress. And having a desire to want to help. Okay? Having a desire to want to help someone in deep distress. And we can see that happening in this account in two different ways, frankly, in two different ways. We can see it, obviously, with Jesus having compassion upon Malchus, okay? That is clear. But there's a greater compassion. There's a greater compassion that's happening right here at this particular moment and, of course, continuing. And that's the compassion of Jesus for the entire world. Compassion, the deep sympathy, the sorrow, and the desire to want to do something, okay? Jesus sees us in our great need, not with ears cut off, but he sees us in the need of sinfulness, condemned to hell, going to be separated from God. He has compassion upon us, and he acts. He has the desire. In the script, it very, very, very clear. Malchus was saying, I know Jesus could have stopped this. He had the power to stop this, but he didn't. Those guards drew back at the sound of his voice. He didn't have to rely upon Peter and his sword. Jesus could have stopped this at any moment that he wanted to, but he didn't. Why not? One word, the word for tonight, compassion. His compassion that he holds in his heart for you and for me and everyone else in this world. And he, therefore, let himself be arrested. He let himself be tried. He let himself be hung on a cross. And he triumphed over it all gloriously. Because that's the help that we needed.
We saw that just a couple of weeks ago when we were looking at Judas. And that script was talking about how Judas maybe was thinking Jesus could escape. And he had. I mean, Jesus multiple times. They'd sought to arrest him and do this already, and it wasn't the time yet. Jesus just, he disappeared. Literally, just one time, he walked straight through people. We get the impression, literally, right through people from that text.
Yeah, so it's, yeah, really.
He could have, and yet he didn't. He stayed right there. He allowed himself to be arrested because he knew what we needed.
Yep. Just real quickly, compassion. The word is used a lot in the scripture. It's used in the Old Testament, particularly in that phrase where the Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, and so on and so forth. Okay, wonderful passage, wonderful. But it's used in the New Testament also about Jesus, and Jesus uses it in two parables. His two probably most famous of all parables. The parable of the Good Samaritan has the word compassion, right? Compassion was shown by the Samaritan to the man who had been beaten. And here was the crossroads in the parable. The man was beaten. The Levite and the priest came, and they walked by. The Samaritan was filled with compassion, and he cared for the man who had been beaten. Okay? So there was one parable. The other parable that has the word compassion in is the parable of the prodigal son. Okay? You know that parable. It's probably the most famous one of all. So you got that son who goes and wastes all that money, wants his dad dead, just wants the inheritance. He goes and blows it all. He comes back. And then it says that while he was still far off, the father saw him coming, and the father was filled with
compassion.
Compassion. Compassion. And he accepted him back. At the same point, so there you got a crossroads. That son's coming back. How are we going to act? The father acted with compassion. But then you have the older son. Remember the older son? He wasn't very compassionate at all. He said, this son of yours, he went and wasted your money. We're not welcoming him back. No way. At least that's how kind of my summary of the whole thing. So you had this crossroads dealing with compassion. So it was a matter of a couple of different things that to think about. Sometimes, and we're running out of time here, but we got sometimes people are in difficult circumstances through no fault of their own. Maybe something happens to them as a victim. Maybe they get sick, whatever, okay? But then you got other circumstances where people bring the stuff upon themselves, where they bring it upon themselves, like that son did who went and wanted everything else like that. Compassion is for everyone. Not just what the people that we think are deserving. That's what the scripture talks about.
Yeah, and that's a point that the whole New Testament points to. In fact, even the Old Testament gets there as well if you read it in light of Christ. And that's the idea that really we're supposed to respond to these things in a radically different way than we do. We're not Malchus. I mean, most of us aren't. Some of you maybe have military training, and that's a little different. But at the same time, we are trained. We have the worldview as Americans that we've been taught is very much so one that we retaliate. We respond. We seek to revenge, well, to avenge. We seek revenge against somebody when they've done harm to us. We don't care for our enemies. We have those hatred things in our heart. Christ, we talked about that a month ago when we had the Sermon on the Mount roll through the lectionary, as Jesus is saying, you've heard an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. I tell you, love your enemy. Pray for those who persecute you. Paul picks up on this in the same way. Romans chapter 12, he wrote, beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God, for it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. To the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink, for by doing so, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. It's a completely different way of thinking than even as, we've grown up as Christians, most of us, but we still get the worldly idea here. And this is a completely different idea, to have compassion, even on your enemy, even on the person who would rather see you dead or out of their life altogether. We still love them. We still, as Paul said, we feed them if they're hungry. We give them something to drink if they're thirsty. This is the way Christ taught us to live and to love our neighbor.
And it's what happened in the Garden of Gethsemane that night. That night. Just one last thing. Malchus in the script said when he's challenged and he's at those crossroads, which way do I go? How do I respond? In the script it said, I see the face of Jesus and the hand reaching out to me. Let that also be our help, our inspiration, so that we can also be compassionate people. Amen. We'll continue our service now with the offering. During the offering, if you haven't yet signed the friendship registers, we'd appreciate if you would do that now. And then after the offering is received, we'll conclude our service with the prayers for the evening. Thank you. And please stand for the prayers of the day. Hear my prayer, O Lord.
Listen to my cry.
Keep me as the apple of your eye.
Hide me in the shadow of your wings.
In righteousness I shall see you. Compassionate God, how grateful and thankful we are that you indeed love us with such undeserved love that you gave your son Jesus to take care of our sins, to defeat the devil, and to overcome death all for us. He willingly laid down his life so that we could have life in his name. And he did it while we were still sinners, when we didn't deserve any of this. Such is the nature of compassion, of divine, holy compassion. So we praise and glorify you for that great gift and pray now that you will help us, inspire us to be people who are compassionate, who do not just give in to our sinful natures or follow the ways of this world, but indeed do things that are truly radically different of showing compassion, showing kindness, showing love in all circumstances, so that through it not only will your name be glorified, but also that people will be blessed and that this world will be such a better place. Lord God, we ask for your compassion also tonight to be with various people in various needs. Today we pray for Cindy Sin as she'll undergo knee replacement surgery on Monday. We truly pray that that will be successful, that the surgeons will be able to do a good thing on her knee and restore her to good health. We also pray again for Jason Gerdes, Janelle's brother-in-law, as he has complications from surgery, and Sandy Geist, as she's been having a difficulty overcoming her illnesses. We pray that your compassion will comfort them and that your healing will indeed restore them. We pray also today for Pam Lundeen, Stephanie Wellick's mother, as she is now receiving hospice care. We pray that your presence will indeed be a comfort to her in these days and that the certainty of your everlasting gift of life will be her comfort and joy. We pray today for Wendy Dalton and her family as they mourn the death of her father, Ordine, who passed away last Saturday. We pray that you will comfort them with the certain and surely hope of a resurrection to everlasting life to all who believe in you. May that hope of a future reunion be their strength and their joy. We pray also then for Larry Gilbert and Carol Nelson and Lyndon Luke, and for other people as they are receiving treatments for cancer, for all those who are in physical need, for those emotionally distressed, and for those with mental issues as well. Be a compassionate God to them and bless them with your love. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Guide us waking, O Lord, and guard us sleeping, that awake we may watch with Christ, and asleep we may rest in peace. Lord, now you let your servant go in peace. Your word has been fulfilled. My own eyes have seen the salvation which you have prepared in the sight of every people, a light to reveal you to the nations and the glory of your people Israel. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Guide us waking, O Lord, and guard us sleeping, that awake we may watch with Christ, and asleep we may rest in peace. And the Almighty and merciful God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless us and keep us. Amen. Amen. thank you for joining us. Go in peace and serve the Lord.